Every so often, in the React world, you get some very clever people who are fed up with some of the limitations of React. Maybe they don't like some of the specific rules that React imposes on us, and they decide to try to break away from it and try to forge their own path and do something completely different. Today is one of such days, and we have a great example of a really interesting library that technically doesn't violate any React code, but on the surface looks like it allows you to break the rules of hooks. So we're going to take a look at this library, we're going to spin it up, we're going to try to understand how it is, how it works, and most importantly, why it was created in the first place. So get ready, get excited. This is going to be a very interesting video. And by the way, if you want to take your React skills to the next level and go beyond what you could possibly learn in any YouTube videos, check out the first links in the description. All right, so here we have a post on X from Jacob Paris that I saw a couple of days ago that was really interesting. It piqued my interest when I saw it in my feed. He says that when React says you need to wrap your code in a component, say no. I've wrapped all of React's code in components so it never yells at you again. Goodbye, rules of hooks. Hello, conditional state. Now, if you know me, if you've watched my videos, you know that I love actually creating small components, reusable components everywhere in the application. So this was very, very interesting to me because he says that when React tells you to do that, which is what React tells you, you should say no and you should do something else. And actually, he's created all of this and put this in a library. Now here, if you read on, he actually showed you some examples and there's people commenting and stuff like that. We're not going to look at that. I will leave a link to this in the description if you want to look at it. What we're going to do is directly jump into the library, play around with it, and see for ourselves how it actually works. So the library is called With React and it has a whopping 45 weekly downloads, right? This is a very small library. I don't think it's really meant to be used in production, but nonetheless, the way that it actually works is really clever. And there's some very insightful lessons that we can learn to actually apply into our own applications, which is ultimately the reason why I'm making this video in the first place. So here I have my editor open and I'm going to show you a couple of examples that this library aims to solve. So here we have a user profile component, right? Pretty simple component. It takes in a user as props and then a show details boolean as props as well, right? It doesn't really matter where these come from. The only thing that matters is that this component actually takes those in as props and needs to use them inside of its body. The user here is a simple object with a name and a last login property, and the show details is of course a boolean. Now here we have a piece of state called last login, right? This is using the use state hook from React, and we're passing it user.lastlogin as its initial value. Then in the body, we're actually showing the user.name. Then here I have some other unrelated code, which is going to be important because that's one of the points that this library is trying to solve. This one is meant to represent other unrelated JSX code inside of this component that doesn't belong to the user or the logged in, which is like a pretty typical use case in React, right? You have big components sometimes, and you have code that is related to different things, right? That's what this represents here. I just didn't want to write it. And then we have show details, and only if show details is true, are we going to render this div over here that shows the last login of the user, and then a button to just update that last login with the current timestamp of the date and time that we're currently on. Right, so this is pretty simple stuff. It shouldn't really surprise anyone. Now, one of the problems that this library aims to solve is that if you look here at this piece of code, right, we have this show details, we have this conditional logic over here. This element over here, right, this div here with all of the code within it, is only ever shown if show details is true. If it's false, it's not shown, and we don't really need to do anything with it. Now, the problem here is that inside of this block, inside of this conditional block, we are using state. We're using last login over here, and then we're calling the updater function of that state function, right, of that state actually, to actually update the state. But this is only conditional, right? So the problem here is that we have some conditional UI, some conditional things, but we don't have conditional state. This last login here has to be there every single time, whether or not show details is true or false. Right, and that's the way that React works. You can't directly put conditional hooks inside of your components, right? That's one of the rules of hooks that you can't break. The other thing that this library tries to solve in this example is here we have a bunch of unrelated code, right? And we have this last login over here that is only related to this piece of code here. Now imagine that this unrelated code also needed some extra pieces of state as well, right? We would have to put them right below here, right at the top of the component, which essentially breaks collocation, right? Ideally, you want to have code that is related together, also co-located very closely within the same file. So you can actually see the code there and then see where it's actually being used. But the way that React currently works and the rules that we have doesn't allow you to do that super easily without creating a component. That's another thing, right? So essentially, if you want to have that, then you're going to have to put all of these states over here. You can have 5, 10 states, whatever. And then you're going to put all of the JSX over here and they're going to be distant, right? They're not going to be co-located as well. So now let me show you how this library tries to solve this. So what we have here now is we're importing this with state component from this custom file with React. Now, this should have been from the actual library with React, but for some reason, I wasn't able to get the types working correctly or even my editor to recognize that I had this library installed. Nonetheless, I actually was able to just go and copy the direct file, the entire library, because it's only one file, and we have it here in our own code base, which is really cool because we can actually take a look at this and see how this actually works. But nonetheless, I've imported this with state component. And what this component does is it basically just creates the ability to have a use state hook, but as a component that you can put conditionally and inside of your JSX, like we did here. So we're passing in here this initial state, which is going to be user.lastlogin. So this is fully type safe because we know that the last login is a date. Then we can actually get the last login here as a function in our children, which is also going to be a date, right? So now here we get our state value, we get the updater function to update that state value, and then we can actually have the same code as we had before, but now it's within a component in the JSX and the state is co-located within it. Right? Because now we no longer have this state here, this last login here at the top of the component. Now it's actually, first of all, conditionally rendered. So we actually have conditional state, right? Which technically violates the rules of hooks, right? But we get around it by actually creating a component, right? So we have this with state here. We can call this conditionally. And then by the power of function children, because if you didn't know, you can actually use children in React as a function and pass them arguments. You can actually get the state value, the updated value, and then just put this component here and solve our problem. And the way that this works is really simple, right? If I go here to the source code, here we have this with state, right? This is a component. It takes in children, takes in an initial state, and then here we just have some types, and all that it does is it creates that state variable here, and then just returns the children, which it calls with the state and the set state, right? So this is super, super simple, and it allows you to have conditional state, and also to have co-located state right here inside of the body, inside of the JSX of the component. Really cool. Now, this technically, right, is creating a component, right? I know that the guy said here on X, he said that when React says you should create a component for it, say no, but he actually did it himself. He meant you shouldn't do it, let him do it instead so that you never have to do it again, which is a valid argument, but it begs the question, would you want to use this in your application? Because this isn't, of course, the only way to solve this, right? What I would have done, right, which is what React usually tells you to do, is to actually create a separate component for this part over here and just put the state variable inside of the component there, right? That way you have co-location and you can also conditionally render this component here and also conditionally render its state, right? So I mean something like this, right? So here I just went ahead and created this user profile details component, right? It takes in a user here, ignore the duplicate types, it's not really relevant. And here we're doing the same thing, we're creating the state over here and we're returning the same body of the function, but now it's in a separate component. We can leave this in the same file if we want to, or if you want to reuse this, we can put it in a separate file and use it across different components, right? And here we're also conditionally technically rendering the actual hooks, right, conditionally, but it's not because it's within the component, right? So the React rules of hooks allows you to actually render stuff conditionally as long as they're inside of a component, right? So again, if it was me personally, I would prefer this approach as well, right, because it falls more in line with the way that React thinks. But nonetheless, the way that we can use this with state here is actually interesting, and there might be some use cases in your application where that would make sense. Another example that they show in the documentation is using hooks inside of a for loop, and it basically functions the same way. So here we have a fruit list component. We have a bunch of fruits here, apple, banana, oranges, and so on. And then we're going to map over each individual fruit. And for each one, we can create this with state hook, pass it some initial state. And here we get, for example, the count and the set count, which we can pretty much do the same thing. Again, you could have also achieved this by creating a separate component, but this is just one other way to do the same thing. Now, this library doesn't only do state, like it doesn't only work with the useState hook. It actually has a couple of components for multiple hooks that come from React. One other example is this formStatus here, right? So this is how you would do it without the library. Essentially, right, we have a search form here. It's wrapped in this form tag over here. We have some input, right? And then we have a button. And basically in the button, we want to actually get the pending state of the form to show if the form is in a pending state, we disable the button, and then we also show submitting. Otherwise, we show the submit button. This is actually one of those use cases where I think that using the library is beneficial, because here we basically have to create an entire component just to have this pending state here, because we cannot use this useFormStatus hook outside of the actual form element. It has to be a child within it, which means that we have to actually create a separate component, because again, you can't use hooks conditionally and you can't use hooks inside of the JSX of a component unless you create a separate component for it. So with the library, this is what it would look like, right? So here we can use the withFormStatus, again, custom component from the library. And here it gives us access to the status, which we can put the button over here, and we can directly access the status inside of the same component that is defining the form. Again, this is a use case that is better because now you don't have to create a separate component just to have a separate button. But usually in your application, you would typically have a lot of use cases, a lot of forms where you might need to have a button, and usually your buttons would look and behave the same way, right? Typically in an application. So even then, it would still be worth it to create a component. But if you have some one-off use case like this, then I can find a use case to justify using this library. But then again, right, this is pretty cool. You can do it here and you can have a great number of flexibility with this library, with this component. And if you look here at the source code, this is again, a very simple component, right? We just receive the children over here, and this one, we just call it with the useFormStatus, right? The return value of useFormStatus. This is to me a little bit weird syntax. I haven't really seen children being called with a hook like this. I think that it's valid React code. I would hope that it is. If it's not, let me know in the comments down below, but I don't seem to be getting errors. So this seems to be legit. But again, this is something that I personally haven't really done when I worked with React. So it's very interesting for me to actually see this in action done this way. Right, and again, I did not make this video for you to now go and actually start using this everywhere instead of useState or useFormStatus or the normal hooks from React, right? I still believe that you should create components whenever possible because it is a superior approach. The reason why I made this video is because it's very interesting to see different ways of building React applications, and this is going to give you more knowledge, more understanding to be able to understand React better, which is ultimately going to make you build better React applications. That's my goal. So yeah, there's some cool stuff here. We have with use as well, which you can actually use with a promise and wrap it in a suspense boundary, right? Again, this uses the same pattern, children, and then the hook itself. We have use with sync external store as well. Really cool. We have with producer, with memo, with ID, right? There's a bunch of things here that feel free to actually go and look at this library to see how it actually does these things and try to use it yourself to see how you feel about it. So yeah, this is the library. It's called with React. It has 45 weekly downloads. Maybe you want to be 46th, right? So go ahead and download it, try it out, read the documentation. You can see the actual examples. Some of these are the ones that we actually covered, but again, it's very interesting. And if you want to join in on the conversation, as I said, I'm going to leave the link to this X post in the description so you can actually check this out. And actually someone here pointed out something very important. I'm pretty sure that this pattern will have problems with React server components, right? Again, I haven't thought about this fully as to how this would impact them, but this is definitely, right, a client component pattern, right? So this obviously only is going to work on the client because you are working with hooks, right? So you can't use this in a server component. And here Samuel said something that I actually relate to, which is actually finding this genuinely hard to hate with use low-key slaps, right? I mean, he's right, right? Like it is weird, it is unusual. It's not something that you would typically see in an application, but it works, it is valid React code. And although it's not the way that React kind of is suggesting you use their framework, right, their library, it's hard to hate because it works and there are some use cases where it could potentially be a better alternative, right? So that's where we are with this library. I would love to hear your thoughts about it. So please leave a comment down below. What do you think about this pattern? Would you use it? Would you not use it? And let's see if we can all just become better React developers. And speaking of becoming a better React developer, you should definitely check out my courses, either Advanced Patterns React if you already have some experience with React, which is shown here, or we also have Project React if you're a complete beginner, because these courses go way beyond what I do in my YouTube videos. They literally teach you everything from A to Z. It's like a complete package, and you will be a significantly better React developer for it. This course, my courses, actually were taken by over 1,000 people at this point, and every single one of them has been satisfied. They love the content, they love the things that they're learning, and all of them have become better React developers. They got better jobs, and you could be one of those people as well. So if you're interested in either of these courses, then the first links in the description are going to be for you. So that's it for me. That's all that I have for this video. If you've enjoyed this, make sure to leave a like, subscribe. It really does help out the channel, and I will see you next time. My name has been Darius Cousin. This is Cousin Solutions. Ciao, ciao.